Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is J.C. Jacobsen. And I have been dead for 130 years. And being dead, imagine my surprise to be invited to talk to you here today. Yeah, well, it may seem odd to get life advice from a dead man, but here I am, and I'm happy to say that I can both hear and see all of you perfectly. So, how are you today? Are you well? Yes, that's nice to hear. And I'm very happy to see that at least one gentleman in your time wears a hat. Wonderful. That's wonderful, sir. Yeah, you in the third row. Lovely. What are these funny candles you sit around with? What is that? I see some lights. Oh, I don't know. The future. Well, I was the founder of Carlsberg. You may know my beer. You may have drunk it. You may have met your wife or husband after drinking it. Well, you can thank me for that later. Or, of course, complain, depending how that relationship developed. But I am not here today to talk about beer. I am here to talk about the philosophy behind the beer. It's a philosophy that I think can help you to break new ground in business and everyday life. Why you should answer every question with the word probably. Probably. We live in a world that craves certainty. Black hats and white hats, left wing and right wing, feast and famine. Everything is absolutely one thing or it's absolutely the other. And the biggest split is between optimists and pessimists. Those who answer every question, yes, and those who answer every question, no. One way to understand why you should answer every question properly is by considering those alternatives. Let's start with optimism. Back in the days, I was very much the patriarch, a serious man, rarely confused with a ray of sunshine. I don't say that stern is always good or that people who laugh noisily in restaurants should be sent to prison. I don't say that. But I do want to take a stance against excessive positivity. Sales departments were a new thing when I was in business. Salesmen were strange and enthusiastic characters who said things like, "It's not a problem, it's a challenge." Or, "It's not a problem, it's a learning opportunity." I don't know if they still talk like that. But I put it to you that sometimes a problem really is a problem. In 1867, my brewery burnt down. Lives were at risk. The business was nearly destroyed. It could have all been over. That was a problem. Dying in a fire is a problem. Calling it a learning opportunity makes you sound like a mad primary school teacher. Problems are bad, and we should recognize that and treat them with due seriousness. There is a sort of tyranny to optimism, a sort of creepy, upbeat repressiveness. If you have to say yes to everything, you really limited your options. The answer to everything isn't yes. If you think it is, you have confused being enthusiastic with being factually correct. And optimism can drift into cowardice. Sometimes we say yes to avoid conflict. This is wrong. We need conflict in business because so many things are uncertain. One person, however hardworking, however far-sighted, can't foresee everything. Conflict is often when you learn what you missed, and relentless optimism and answering every question with a yes denies us that conflict and that learning. Losses are losses. Stop being positive about everything. So, that's optimism. What about pessimism? If you shouldn't answer every question with a yes, maybe you should answer them with a no. Pessimism certainly feels cleverer than optimism. We feel on a visceral level that the pessimism is rude. We feel clever when we criticize things. We feel powerful when we say no. But I put it to you, ladies and gentlemen, that pessimism, answering every question with a no, is as soggy-headed as optimism. And it's less fun to be around. Like optimists, pessimists retreat into simple certainties. Everything is rubbish. Everything will end badly. Well, that isn't an intellectually robust philosophy. Admittedly, pessimists are better at predicting outcomes than optimists. But if you look closely at the data, it isn't because they're smarter. Pessimists often get it right for the simple reason that things fail more often than they succeed. Also, pessimists are often right because their pessimism causes things to fail. If you think you won't do something well, you know what? You probably won't. Pessimism predicts the future correctly by making its own dark future. So, don't be an optimist. And don't be a pessimist. They are ways of creating false certainty. I lived through a period of rapid change. The 18th century era was an agrarian society. By the end of the 19th century, it was an industrialized urban society. Vast changes. Times of great change make people worried, and they often respond by retreating into fantastical beliefs, lucky charms, conspiracy theories, extreme religion and extreme politics. The human craving for certainty spills out in all sorts of ways. Don't believe it. Allow that things are uncertain. Propitiating crazy gods in the hope of restoring order is a bad habit to get into. The Aztecs made human sacrifices on the tops of their temples, allowed the blood to flow down the sides, then ate the bodies. Because they thought it would keep the sun in position in the sky. Now, I don't want to get into criticism of religion, but don't eat people. That's not how the sun works. The world cannot be made to fit neatly like a jigsaw. And we don't need to read a lot of history books to see that societies that attempt to create absolute certainty are societies you absolutely wouldn't want to live in. We'll never have complete information. We'll never have perfect information, but we must have the courage to act anyway. We mustn't freeze up in the face of uncertainty. We must lean into it, make a virtue out of it. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the probably mindset. The virtue of probably is that it's scientific. I always had a passion for the scientific method, which is more or less synonymous with the idea of probably. The scientific method says you come up with a hypothesis and then you relentlessly test it to try and prove it wrong. We set up a laboratory in 1876 to do just that. Day in and day out, test our theories scientifically. Nowadays, it might seem normal to link research and business, but it was new back then, and it was pure probably. Probably is the opposite of dogmatic belief. We accepted that our theories were only our current best guess, and that a new, better idea might be discovered at any time. What if you treated your own life as a series of little scientific experiments? A yes mindset is a static mindset. It says, we worked everything out and it's done and we are sticking. The probably mindset, the scientific method, says we never arrive at perfection. We are always aiming for it. But it's of the nature of perfection that you can never get there. And that gap between yes and probably is where improvement happens. Probably is traveling expectantly, but never arriving. Yeah, that's how to live. Enjoy traveling forward, getting better at things, but knowing you'll never get perfect. One more reason you should answer every question with probably is that it allows you to do things just because they feel right. You can build your hypothesis on a feeling, then see what happens. You don't always have to lock down your reasoning. You don't have to present a status report to the middle manager in your head. I used to share my clean yeast with other brewers. I won't bore you with the ins and outs of brewing yeast, but brewers need it, and I shared mine, even with rivals. Maybe that was a bad move. Maybe a sharper businessman would have pounced when his rivals were out of yeast and gobbled up their businesses. I don't know. I like the idea that within a field of industry, we are a community. I answer questions probably, and I reserve the right to do things because they feel like the thing to do. In 1859, the Frederiksborg Castle, the old home of the King of Denmark, burned down. I gave a lot of money to help rebuild it. Denmark had lost the war to Germany. Part of our country was annexed. The spirits were low. The Frederiksborg Castle was a symbol of unity. It felt like a good idea to repair it. And, ladies and gentlemen, it's a beautiful castle. And passing beautiful things to future generations strikes me as a worthwhile thing to do. Was it a smart investment? A pure economist might say no. I say Looking at just the economics of a situation can be another way to hide uncertainty. If you add emotions to the balance sheet, you embrace uncertainty and move towards a probably mindset. Give away your yeast, whatever is the yeast in your life. Rebuild beautiful castles just because they are beautiful. These are probably decisions, and you won't regret them. They are the sorts of decisions that make the world a better place today for a better tomorrow. I died 130 years ago, and as I said, being dead, I didn't think I'd be called on to deliver any more speeches, but we can never be certain how things will turn out. All we can do is enjoy the uncertainty, set out our hypothesis with courage and hope, and walk forward into the fog. Who knows? You too could find yourself on a stage talking about your life long after it's over. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why you should answer every question with the word, probably.